What we are looking at here is a chart that was created on March 20th. That's today, and the source is from the Japanese atomic industry. And what we have is a spreadsheet on the status of the 6 nuclear power plants. So we go over here to the left, and I want to go right down to what really matters, the water level and reactor pressure vessel, just underneath building integrity. And if we'll notice, we've got 3 reactors that fuel exposed partially or fully, okay, and they're in the red down here. Each one of the 2, 1, 2, and 3, fuel exposed partially or fully, okay. Once this happens, it goes into several thousand degrees and starts to have these plumes of bone cancering causing substances, okay. And what we had initially was in reactor 4, and this is what the news reports were talking about, severely damaged hydrogen explosion, and then the cores were safe. So basically you had the top, basically the lid blew off the pressure cooker, okay? But the stuff down inside didn't have any, horrible damage to it, like you see here in reactors 1, 2, and 3, okay? So this is the problem, and we don't just have a Chernobyl. We have Chernobyl times 3, okay? So I don't know what the actual weight of the these components here, the mass volume, is it like several hundred pounds of this stuff, so you could get some relative nature between Chernobyl and this these 3 power plants. So that would be like a really good question to answer. So I don't know where to find that information, but it's a question I have. So the next thing that I'm concerned with, how can we test for this when nobody has a detector? Okay, you can't buy any rad detectors. And the way they're setting these things up, if you look at some of my other videos I've had, they don't even know how to set them up to get accurate readings, and it's actually a joke. And I've tried to talk to some of these people, and they, it's like talking to a wall, okay? So as an individual, you want to be intelligent, you want to protect yourself and be safe. The hazardous materials within these, reactors that are off-gassing, they can be detected if you use what I'd call a calcium filter. And you can basically take seashells or animal bone, dogs chew on these bones, and you can buy them in the, at stores that sell dog bones. And you basically need to crush this stuff up. And you could probably crush it up and put it into a PVC tube and have the rainwater somehow funnel down in through this filter, thereby allowing the contaminants to cling to the bone in the filter. And then you could spread that out and put a black light, UV light, illuminate it with a UV light. But I would first, illuminate it with a very bright 250-watt light to get it to excite. And then you can, look at it with a UV light. Now, here's the thing you want to look for. Far as my research has uncovered, is that the color is going to be green. Okay, so the background calcium of the bone will be kind of a purple, a light purple. And everyone's, had a white T-shirt on a dance floor and seen that color. So the natural calcium is going to have an illumination of kind of like a light purple. But you're going to see areas of green, okay, a green fluoresce characteristic, okay? So I believe you could still test for this, and you're going to be looking at it in parts per million. And see, that's an important thing here, because by the time it goes 4,000 miles from Fukushima to the Pacific coast, you're going to have it in parts per million, okay? And the only way to really detect anything is to have it filter, filter several gallons of rainwater down through a crushed bone, gravel filter. I would crush it up just enough so that the water can still get through. Don't make it so small that, the water can't pass through, but don't make it so large that if there is any contaminants, it doesn't have time to cling to the calcium, because the nature of this stuff is to cling to the calcium. And I did a great deal of research to find this, okay, to learn about that. And anyway, that's something I might do a video in the future about. So, and I want to just, you know, to summarize, there are six reactors. The reason that a lot of people didn't think there was anything to be concerned with was because of what was taking place in Reactor 4. And they were making a blanket statement saying that all reactors had Reactor 4, you know, situation where the cores weren't exposed, the rods weren't exposed, yet there was like a hydrogen explosion. They were trying to use this as the statement for all reactors. But as you can see here from the data, sourced Japanese atomic industry, we have some exposed rods. And they've been exposed for over a week now, okay? Because right today, it's Sunday, and this event happened, the earthquake happened on a, I believe it was a Thursday night of last week. So we've had this exposure for more than 7 days, okay? So you've got this high heat, you know, thousands of degrees temperature, and it's off-gassing, okay? And it's, you know, so for those who are the skeptics saying, well, it ain't going to reach here, nothing to be afraid of. What about the food chain and all of the food that is taken out of the Pacific coast? You know, all the food that is, taken out of the ocean. What does that do for that? I mean, are those contaminants going to go into the water and to cause contamination there? And a lot of the experts are trying to, like, you know, make that sound all rosy by saying, oh, it just turns into some other substance and it's no longer life-threatening. Well, you know, you're more than welcome to go and order up yourself a nice big plate of the stuff that's been deemed safe by the experts, you know, and, you know, you be the first to test that, because I'm going to be a little bit more intelligent about this and realize that, you know, we're going into the unknown here, you know, only time will tell, but that's all I have for right now, and thanks for watching.